3, 2, 1.
Last month, a group of college students sent a rocket into space. The Traveler 4 traveled over 300,000 feet at a top speed of 3,386 miles per hour to break through the Kármán line, an internationally recognized border between Earth and space. Some private companies have already achieved this, but this is the first collegiate team to have designed, built, and launched a rocket into space, and we have one of the lead engineers here to tell us all about it.
Hi, my name is Neil Tewksbury, and I'm the new lead for the USC Rocket Propulsion Lab, and we just launched the first fully student designed and built rocket to space.
Tell us a little bit about that moment when you realized that you had accomplished this goal. Like, what is going through your mind?
On the day of, we heard over the radio transmission that the parachutes have been deployed.
The drone had fired.
Which means that the avionics system had worked, that the rocket was still intact, and that the parachutes were going to carry the rocket down safely. That was the moment when we realized the rocket had functioned properly. We were absolutely ecstatic. Though we didn't know at that point if we had made it to space or not, comes later down the road when we were doing data analysis. But at that point, we knew that the rocket had worked and had stayed intact and was still transmitting data, which was unprecedented for us to be getting data on the way down. So we knew the rocket had worked. We thought there's a pretty good chance it made it based on all of our simulations, and we were all crying. We could not believe it. It was a truly amazing time.
And your goal was to pass the Kármán line. Can you tell us what that is and what makes it a significant benchmark?
The Kármán line is the line internationally denoted as the entry point into space. You know, it's not a hard and fast line. Everything is continuous through the atmosphere, but 100 kilometers was chosen because all the scientists agreed that this was a space-like environment. And so this line became an internationally recognized boundary for space. Some other entities like NASA use a line a little bit lower at 52 miles to declare space. But we went ahead and we're shooting for the internationally recognized line.
So how are you able to confirm that Traveler 4 actually made it into space?
Because we didn't have any external radar sensing us, because that would have been prohibitively expensive. We had to rely on our own avionics unit. So we built a full avionics, which means flight electronics unit that sat inside of our nose cone that recorded all of the data for the flight. So there were a whole variety of sensors on board, including a couple different GPS units, and then a whole host of accelerometers and IMUs to record the rocket's position. So what we had to do was stitch together all the data that we got from all of our accelerometers and then the GPS units. So the GPS only worked near the end of the flight when the rocket was going low enough and slow enough for GPS to actually function properly. And so the rest of the flight was stitched together with the accelerometers using very careful integration techniques.
Let's talk about preparing a rocket for space flight. What kinds of tests did you have to run?
We actually have to do a lot of testing, because as anyone would do, but especially in our situation, because we only get to launch a space shot every once in a while. And it's not like we have access to a hypersonic wind tunnel. We were designing this vehicle to fly at 5 times the speed of sound. There are only a couple wind tunnels on Earth that can provide that we don't have access to. So we were having to do all of our testing and preparing with what tools we had available to us. So, for example, the entire motor we tested by strapping it to the ground and performing what's called a static fire. So that is burning the entire motor, releasing all of the thrust, but while it's strapped to the ground, so we can see how the performance works out there. We did a number of tests on the ground with Traveler before we flew it even. And this includes recovery testing, making sure we can deploy the nose cone. We did hydrostatic testing, which is where you pressurize the entire motor case to ensure that it can survive the motor pressure. Because you can imagine there's basically an explosion going off on the inside of the vehicle that you have to contain. And then we did a number of, blowtorch tests and anything we can do to simulate the environment that it was going to be in.
What kind of fuel are you using to get this thing up there?
We're using an actual ammonium perchlorate composite propellant. So this is a solid rocket fuel, very similar to what's found in the space shuttle boosters. So it's literally a solid fuel that we pack by hand and we mix by hand. And with a little bit of help from a mixer, we put all of the raw ingredients together using our own formula that's been developed over, 15 years, and cast it into grains, so little chunks that we slide into the rocket. And then it's essentially like shoving a bunch of firewood into the rocket. It's completely solid, completely inert, but it definitely is a great experience for us to get to both design and manufacture the propellant completely ourselves.
Yeah, I'll bet. And so this is something that you've actually developed at USC in the Rocket Propulsion Lab.
You can think of it like the Krusty Krab secret formula.
So the Rocket Propulsion Lab is obviously a student-led group. What is it like trying to work with the government on a space launch as a college student?
That is a major task, especially in the beginning. That was as big of a task as building the rocket. So Traveler was the first time students had ever requested and were able to receive flight clearance for a space shot. So that was like a 3 or 4 year process to get all of the clearance done, because essentially we have to convince the government to trust us to build a vehicle that isn't going to cause any harm. And so that includes rigorous simulations on our side, lots of testing and displaying all of our technology to them so that they can trust us. And that really paved the way for not just us, but all university programs with Traveler One, because now there's an actual protocol for, getting a rocket cleared to fly a space shot that any university can follow. And especially for us with having a history, this process is getting smoother and smoother every time. For example, the Traveler 4 launch, everything was going smoothly until the government shut down, which delayed us a couple months. So these are just things you have to keep in mind when you're working with the government. It's definitely a huge factor for us, but it builds great skills for the future of having to work in the commercial space industry.
What was the biggest challenge in designing the rocket and then actually getting the rocket into space?
I would say that all members of our team, worked on very difficult challenges. One of the biggest ones that we weren't able to test is how to get a vehicle to survive hypersonic flow. So our rocket is traveling at 5 times the speed of sound in lower atmosphere, which is pushing the limits of what standard materials can survive. And so our rocket was actually being shredded on the way up. And we lost a lot of material, both on the rocket body and on the fins. And luckily, we had just enough extra material on there for the rocket to survive.
And this is actually the fourth iteration of the Traveler. Can you tell us a little bit about those versions 1 through 3 and what's changed to get it to the place where it is now?
Traveler 1 was launched in 2013. Well, I guess it wasn't called Traveler 1. It was just called Traveler. It was expected to work, as all of our rockets are, but of course it, catastrophically failed on the way up, as did Traveler 2. These both failed seconds into flight. So the majority of the flight, we had no idea what was going to happen for sequential rockets. So Traveler 1 and 2 were, amazing achievements to be able to get the rocket on the pad, fully built, fully, ignited. Everything went great. The rocket just, failed and fell apart basically on the way up, which, should be expected for any budding space program to have a couple of failures along the way. And then a couple of years were taken to kind of reestablish our technology. So that improved a lot of our thermal protection systems in our motor. We improved our avionics unit. We improved our structures. We had a whole new filament winding process for our cases. And then Traveler 3 was launched in the fall of this previous year, so 2018, with all of these new upgrades, but there was a miscommunication in the avionics unit, wasn't armed properly prior to launch, so the rocket didn't know to deploy its parachutes and just crashed into the ground. Then we upgraded all of our procedures, all of our, even upgraded some of the avionics protocols, and then started on Traveler 4, made a very similar vehicle, and it also performed just as we expected, although this time the avionics worked and the parachutes were deployed. So every step, we make a huge strides to improve our process.
Do you think that means that we're closer to amateur space travel?
I would say we're pretty far away from amateurs actually sending themselves to space, just because that is an incredible endeavor. humans flying is a lot different than us sending a couple cameras up there. But that is definitely, you know, slightly more possible thanks to amateurs proving that you can get to the very edge of space, but there's no way anything could have survived on our rocket, much less like a person.
And you've spoken a little bit about paving the way for other student groups. What's the significance of having pulled this off as a college student?
Well, what I would say is that a lot of people have paved the way for us. So a lot of, you know, students from starting in 2005 have been pouring their entire heart and soul into this project. You know, their late nights, their long hours, every single day they're working on this project for the last 15 years. I would say that they've been paving the way as much as we are for everyone else. And so I feel extremely lucky to be able to work in a lab with this much collected knowledge and be able to contribute to it. What's hard about college is that we're only here for a couple of years and you lose your best 25% every single year. It's not quite like that in industry. So we have to work really hard on, you know, carrying forward our data, carrying forward what we know, what we learned, lessons learned, try not to repeat the same failures over and over.
So what's next for the team? What's next for you?
You never know. The sky's not quite the limit anymore. So we'll see what we can do.
Well, we look forward to seeing what's next for you. Best of luck to your team, and thank you so much for taking the time to chat, Neil.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks.